All right, those are a lot of trading ideas for you. But now let's invite Prakash Diwan of PrakashDiwan.in and Siddharth Bhamre of Angel Broking to give us their views on individual stocks and of course the market as a whole. Prakash is a secret auto analyst as well, so we'll ask him about all the auto stocks. Prakash, what's happening with this whole Volkswagen issue? I mean, it's larger than just a product recall, you know. And which are the Indian companies that could get impacted because of this?
Yeah, so I think it's probably one of its kind in terms of a setback to the industry, and it's definitely something surprising coming from such a marquee name, and the impact could be much more because this will mean that the US regulators and even the European regulators for that matter might start getting very stringent about checking on emissions. The impact for Indian companies, of course, the largest is Motherson Sumi, 40% comes from the group, but luckily, you know, the US market, the cars for the US market which Motherson Sumi supplies to is just about 10% overall. So it may have an impact, but not necessarily so large. There's a lot of unlisted players who supply to Volkswagen. Volkswagen has in fact a lot of forgings going into its cars in the US, which is almost all of it is from the Indian segment. So I know of a lot of unlisted people who are really in a bad state, going to be in a, you know, big setback of sorts.
So Bharat Forge is not impacted, right?
No, Bharat Forge wasn't one of the suppliers there because Volkswagen had these vendors which were developed over a period of time, and they have this captive theory of, you know, getting business from captive vendors, not from open OEM suppliers. But you know, the impact, my sense is the impact could be on other European players. So you will start seeing a shakeout of sorts even in, let's say, the engine manufacturer, which today you have a marquee stock like Foss Motor, which is thriving on Mercedes and the BMWs of the world. If something goes wrong to this, so you know, this whole thing of supplying to marquee names and being overdone on that one client segment and one client itself, it makes you extremely vulnerable. So Motherson Sumi luckily is very diversified. I don't think it's going to get so badly impacted. In fact, it's a good opportunity to buy into the stock because of this sentimental slowdown of sorts. And generally auto ancillaries are getting derated of sorts. You know, it's really, you know, they're no more.
Yeah, it's a bunch of bad news that's come together. Yes, Amtec auto hits you and then you have this Volkswagen.
If you see globally, also it's stock specific. It's not that the industry is kind of crashing or coming down. In fact, Brazil, you know, one important thing which has happened is Brazil is out of the way for a lot of people who were competing with that part of the business. Brazil used to supply a lot of components to the US markets. The way India has always been more towards the European markets because of proximity, of course, and logistics more favorably disposed towards from Brazil. Now, if Brazilian companies are going to shut down because of high interest costs, high wage costs, high royalty costs, Indians can actually fill in that gap. And there are companies which...
I see, that's what I wanted to ask you. If Volkswagen has to beat a hasty retreat, that vacuum has to be occupied by some other autos, some other cars.
The Japanese.
And therefore, exactly, so who are the suppliers there?
No, so the Japanese...
Cars and suppliers.
No, in fact, the Japanese have so much of JVs in India.
So does Bharat Forge supply to, you know, Japanese cars? What I'm saying is auto ancillary units supplying to that... could therefore gain.
So it depends. So there's, you know, in a car the kind of number of components that are involved is so huge that you really can't kind of, you know, have a very cut and dried kind of a math on that. But what will happen is it will throw open the market for a lot of Indian suppliers. Mm-hmm. In fact, you know, the likes of the guys who supply larger components, engines, plates, chassis stuff, you know, all those are the ones who get benefit much more. The smaller stuff can come from a lot
can
of
you
other
name
places.
Some listed stocks?
So, you know, actually Amtec used to do a lot of stampings and all that, but I don't know whether they're right now in that position. But Motherson Sumi can switch and start supplying to the other players, you know, because they already have the competence, they already have the know-how. And a lot of other smaller companies can now start scaling up because they can set up a dedicated unit for a new Japanese company which sees, you know, that market kind of growing. You know, the other thing which is happening is globally, the Japanese have always had a price advantage. Now, because of the fuel costs coming down, there was a shift towards high-end cars from the European side, which were gas guzzlers, relatively not so efficiently run. Now the trend will again reverse, where people would start getting worried about these, the sustainability of these cars. So, but it will be positive for the likes of JLR because there's a gap that JLR fills in from a price advantage where Audi slips down. Mm-hmm. Audi has always been the closest competitor to the Jag, if you know, if that could happen, you would probably see some sort of a revival of sentiment on the Tata Motors stock because of that. Oh, because the American market is fairly large. Mm-hmm. And it could set off the losses that the Chinese market has created for JLR.
Okay, that's an interesting observation. But we just come to you on your individual stocks in a bit. Before that, let's get Siddharth Bhamre into our conversation as well. Siddharth, it's been a couple of days where the Nifty has, you know, bucked the global trend and has been on an upward trajectory. Do you think this 8,000 level could be a hurdle up until expiry, or do you think that could be taken out?
Good morning, Sonia. The kind of volatility we are seeing in market, you know, just 30-40 points, 8,000 levels there. I don't think so one should consider that as a hurdle. I think hurdle would be, just sometime before technical guy was also talking about one candlestick which has been formed and which is making a lot of people wary about, market going up. I think first market would try to beat that pattern and, try to create consensus that probably there is further upside in this market, and which we are seeing that 8,000 call option, 8,300 call options are also showing built up, though the premium is hardly 2 to 3 rupees. I am not saying you go long over here, but the way FIS data has also panned out, especially in cash market segment after the Fed event, these guys were buyers last 2 sessions of 800 crores. Though in larger scheme of things, if I see from last expiry to this expiry and do summation of their cash based activity, there is still 11,000 crores sell figure in equity market. Interestingly, Friday's session, 480 crores of long positions formed in index futures, but the open interest rise was quite significant, which suggests it is blend of long short. And yesterday we have seen huge formation of short positions in index futures after 7th of September. Such large positions were created on the short side. So certainly I am not bullish on market, but what I feel is, looking at the volatility, looking at the global markets which are, you know, in positive terrain, Shanghai probably would try to reach towards 3,200, 3,300, where it has resistance. So all these factors club together, I think we might have some headroom. I am not going to play for that headroom. So what we are going to do is, till the time market is not decisively going down, we would be, more stock specific. There are large cap short ideas, there are mid cap long ideas. We would be trading stock specific. But this market as of now is not out of the woods, and we might be heading downwards, but probably after some rise.
Okay, let me get you a specific stock. You have a sell on L&T.
Yeah, the stock has been underperforming. Large cap stock, FIS favorite stock. Retail don't trade much over here because of the denomination of the stock. And if you've observed, in recent fall, there is huge shorting which is taking place in this counter. And though market has bounced back substantially from lower levels, L&T didn't bounce much. And after that, we are seeing that during the rise, there were good volume, there were less volume. And during the fall, volumes are high. We are seeing formation of fresh short positions over here. This is a large cap stock, heavyweight stock, and is also representing market movements. There is a direct correlation if you see Nifty and L&T. So I'm expecting downside in L&T would underperform. Even if Nifty bounces, say probably 100 points from current levels, L&T may not bounce significantly. So even at current levels, one can short. My targets are pretty aggressive over here. So I would have, bit stretch stop loss also. So stop loss would be around 1611 and target is around 1397. So this is one heavyweight stock which is in formation of short positions and we are bearish.
Okay. Well, Prakash, to come back to you, among the stocks that you are looking at now positively is Balakrishna Industries.
Yeah, so, this is a stock that I had spoken about 6 months back also, but, one of the reasons why I have kind of revived the interest here is, one is valuation, of course. It's kind of slid a bit from its peak. And generally, if you see the tire business, the tire industry in India, it still continues to benefit out of this benign input side. And look at all-time highs being made by some of the players, SEAT for instance yesterday. And the momentum in Apollo and MRF continues to be as strong. Now, what's going to happen to the industry is there will be a plateauing off for mostly all these players, especially the ones who are into exports. Balkrishna stands out because it's into the off-road tires. They supply those big tires which go into dumpers. Those excavators, those JCB kind of stuff. That is a segment which is very high margin. Of course, there is a degrowth there because mining and construction is on a ebb of sorts globally. But in Europe, that's kind of seen some sort of a revival. And they've set up a plant in Kutch recently with internal accruals and a little bit of cash. which is going to actually manufacture a lot of large size radials, which is for trucks, which is another segment that's very promising. And the CV cycle is, you know, exactly well timed for them. I think they'll have very decent ratios coming out in the subsequent quarters, and they also hedged pretty well with the euro all the way up till FY17. So I don't see currency losses hitting them as much as some of the other players could get impacted. So net, it's kind of, you know, a good value stock, but you'll have to be patient. You know, it's not something which is going to start riding in the next week or so.
Okay, actually the tire stock that's done exceptionally well has been SEAT, as the chart is showing. Yeah. You think SEAT is overpriced?
I think we'll start seeing some fatigue there. You know, we saw this happen at about 750-800 levels for SEAT for a fairly long time. There was a consolidation, and then it moved. If you have options, you would want to definitely go into something which has more headroom for growth. So I'm sure people will start looking out for that now that SEAT is kind of peaking out.
Yeah, people were saying fatigue at 700, at 900, at 1000, and now at 1200 as well. But we have one more minute before the pre-opening level. So Siddharth, just take us through your strategy on IDF Cellular.
So IDF has been underperforming again, no bounce back, and so has been Bharti. But what we have observed in IDF yesterday, that there is around 10% rise in open interest, and this is near to very strong support. So though we are not expecting huge change in trend in IDF, but certainly I am expecting a short covering bounce which can take this stock probably to 164 odd levels. So buy at current price with a stop of 137. Short covering bounce is what I am expecting here.
Alright, well, maybe you can also take us through your next buy call on M&M Financial.
So Lata, very quickly, M&M, technically if you see, there is a hammer formation which has happened bang near to the support here, and you are seeing that, you know, financial stock doing better. It has good amount of short position standing in it, and yesterday there was 10% rise in open interest, which clearly suggests that it is blend of long and short. So here too, like IDF, I am expecting a short covering bounce, and outperformance of banking would continue for a day or two, which would help banking, M&M Financial.
Okay, I won't ask you any more questions because we are getting the pre-opening rates. It's starting wildly, so maybe we'll just leave it alone for the moment. The Sensex is still dilly-dallying. We have to wait and see where the rates settle. The rupee had closed at 65.75, was it? That the rupee closed? 65.72. So let's see whether we are likely to see any improvement in the rupee itself. Very wavered movements. The Nifty is way higher, and the Sensex still trying to open its account. And the rupee is opened marginally stronger, about 5 pi stronger. But we still await, I think, more clarity on the Nifty itself. Well, Siddharth, will you play the Bank Nifty at all?
I will not play for the bounce as such. Stock specific, yes, but especially PSU banks we are liking, and that too again from a short term bounce. So stocks like Canara, Bank of India, you were talking sometime back, UCO, all these stocks are looking good on charts as well as from data perspective. But will I, you know, do a big positional trade for a targets more than 10 to 15%? Answer to that is no. Bank Nifty, after taking that support around 16,200, has bounced back significantly. I think resistance is calling around between 17,500 to 18,000. I am not seeing Bank Nifty above 18,000 even if there is a rate cut. This is a sell on rise candidate for us. Options liquidity is there, ratio spreads can be found for current series remaining 2 days left, where, you know, you can cap the losses if Bank Nifty is going up, and probably leave the downside open. So yes, there would be a bounce back in Bank Nifty in an anticipation that rate cut is happening, and it may happen, but sustainability of that bounce is a big question.
Alright, well, in pre-opening, the levels have settled higher for sure, so looks like it's going to be a good start to trade. A couple of stocks deserve mention. There was fresh long positions added yesterday in names like Maruti and Dish TV, so let's see whether those stocks are moving up higher. SKS Microfinance also saw a bit of buying in trade yesterday, so that stock too could be on an uptrend. and there was big delivery selling of 150 crores in Madison Sumi. So it would be interesting to see whether there's any kind of recovery or is there continuous sell-off in Madison Sumi. Seems like the red tick could continue over there. But the pharma space from the frontliners seems to be gaining a lot of traction. So Dr. Reddy's is up 3%, Sun Pharma is up 1.5%, and then you have a couple of others as well that are gaining steam. From this space, Prakash, is there anything that catches your eye?
You know, I think you probably see a little bit of a re-rating for most of the large pharma players, especially the ones which are US focused, thanks to Mr. Clinton's tweet on bringing down costs for the healthcare segment, and that's brought all those biotech companies down in the US last night. Now, which means that you'll have to depend on generic imports, which are cheaper. And India definitely stands to gain there. So anything which is now off patent and which is kind of not in the ambit of the US FDA, the regulators per se will benefit. So Dr. Reddy's is the top beneficiary there. You'll probably have Glenmark with a huge pipeline benefiting significantly. And to a large extent, it could be Sun Pharma and Lupin. But the top order, the order remains very clearly Dr. Reddy's, Glenmark and Sun Pharma. So I would believe today you'll see some price action there, and which could be sustainable if there's more legs to what the likely next US president thinks about this particular sector.
Okay, actually Bajaj Auto is starting with a big gain, 6% higher. Anything in the automobile space itself, Prakash, we spoke at length about the ancillaries. Any of the automobile stocks?
You know, after a long time that I have started getting a little bit of a view, sharing this view on Maruti, that it could kind of top out of sorts. No particular reason or trigger as such, but it's, the fact that Maruti is kind of seeming slightly overvalued as compared to peers. There's one, we always paid a premium for the unique positioning that it had, but its focus on the premium segment, now that it's also relaunched the Baleno hatchback in the premium segment, which will be only sold through Nexa. You know, these are efforts which prove to be quite expensive, because they first don't get you volumes, and secondly they're not also very high margin at this point in time because of the entry that it's trying to make. The moment it takes its eyes off the entry level, which is A and B, and some other companies could kind of move in. Of course, we don't have to bother with Volkswagen now there, but you know, there are a lot of other companies, particularly the Renault has launched a very competitive model, which I had mentioned some time back, called the Quid. And if that were to eat into category A and B segments for Maruti, which is its bread and butter business, it would need to get slightly re-rated. So I wouldn't be surprised if that happens. What I like in the auto space, continue to like, is Ashok Leyland. Yeah, I think it's kind of definitely offering value at these levels also. And in the two-wheeler space, I would believe Hero MotoCorp would start kind of seeing a comeback of sorts. You know, Bajaj Auto is probably, you know, still iffy on certain counts because of the export orientation, but Hero will probably bounce back very strongly.
Okay, yes, the Quid, and the pricing of the Quid looks good,
yes,
3-4 lakhs, I mean, that's hardly anything,
yeah,
right?
And the kind of feature it offers, straddle across the category A and category B entry levels, you know, so it's fairly powerful in terms of ability to get market share.
Alright, well, one more pocket of stocks that you should be aware about is the entire Amtech group. Once again, Amtech Auto, Castex Technology are all under pressure this morning. As we told you yesterday, Amtech Auto has now defaulted on 800 crores worth of bond payments. They matured yesterday and that default has taken place, and this loan will have to be classified as a bad loan if they do not cough up the funds to make this particular bond payment. So that entire group will be under pressure. But before let you go, Prakash, you have another long-term strategy. Kaveri Seeds is a stock that you're recommending.
That's right, that's
what's the story there?
Yeah, so you know, this is also proving to be an interesting play, Sonia. I mean, we've seen this stock being, you know, one of the blue chips in that limited space of agro players, but from that almost 1100 levels, it's moved down to the 400 zone. Because people didn't like a few accounting things that the company did. There was a 64 crores provisioning which they were supposed to make, the contingent liability thanks to some royalty payouts which were due to Monsanto if the government of India and Monsanto have a dispute. And if the government loses that, all these players would have to pay for the BT hybrids that seed companies have been using. Now, that is something that the company refused to do, saying that we are very sure that the government is going to win, and even if the government loses out, we will not be paying because of certain other assumptions that they've made. So people didn't, somehow the analysts didn't like that idea, and there was a sell-off. Now what's happening is there's a veritable change in the entire pattern of this industry. There's something called HDP, mm-hmm. which is high density plantation, which is coming in. Earlier you could throw seeds, scatter them, and they would grow. Now you'll have to do it in a slightly different way, and you can't use hybrid seeds there. So it's suddenly, you know, hybrid seeds are no more valid as a very strong product segment, and you would have to move to what's called the OPV, which is the open pollen variety, which is your good old traditional seeding technology. And that means all companies will have to relaunch. And I read about this market change in the DRHP that Nuzivedu Seeds has filed, because they're looking at going public, and they've very elaborately explained the market and the kind of dynamics. So from that you can very clearly discern that if there's a relaunch of sorts, which actually will have to happen because India is seeing a shortage of space and you know, labor and all of that to increase productivity, and this changes it all to almost like 6 to 10 times. So there's no way farmers can avoid it. But a relaunch means that only companies which have great brand recall and a good distribution will win. So Kaveri can, you know, benefit out of that tremendously. So of course this will be over the next 3 years, 4 years. It's not something immediate, and it's always posted very good numbers. It has decent cash, it's got a decent market cap, interest from FIs, domestic institutions. So overall it's a good value stock, very close to its 52-week lows, and has enough triggers to move it forward.
All right, Prakash, thank you very much for joining us with those picks, thank you to you as well, Siddharth. Sona, you want to recap Siddharth's picks?
All right, let's do that. Well, the pre-opening levels have settled higher, so looks like 8,000 could be here today and could sustain as well. But if you missed out on Siddharth Bhamre's picks for today, here they are. He recommends buying M&M Financial with a target of 257 and a stop loss of 229. Idea is also on his buy list with a target of 164 and a stop loss of 137. And finally, he recommends selling L&T with a target of 1397 and a stop loss at 1611. So those are Siddharth Bhamre's ideas. But let's also get you some more strategies. We have a bullseye contest on every